When it comes to COVID, it's generally best to follow Neil Finn's advice. Don't dream it's over. But the defiant Danes are daring to dream.
Vi er klar til at træde ud af coronaens skygge. Vi siger farvel til restriktionerne. Og velkommen til det liv, vi kendte før corona.
The nation of 5.8 million has been recording more than 50,000 daily cases on average. But the number of COVID patients in ICU has dropped from 82 to 28 over the last few weeks.
With Omicron, we simply don't need anymore to flatten the curve as much as we used to.
So now, Denmark's famously tolerant attitude towards nudity will extend to tolerance of naked faces, except in hospitals and aged care. They're also ditching check-ins and vaccine passports.
Now we just float away and say, welcome everybody.
The WHO is a little nervous.
Now is not the time to lift everything all at once. We have always urged caution.
But ordinary Danes are cautiously optimistic about both the weather.
The weather is nice.
Said it's outside.
Blue, clear sky as today.
And also about COVID.
I think it's about time, yeah.
It's wonderful, but still a little bit scary.
And we can dance and, yeah, just be yourself again and don't worry about the corona.
And for all us jealous Aussies watching on, here's how they did it.
It seems like the Danish society came together and most people are vaccinated, which means we can do this.
The precautions are part of everyday life, so we don't have to educate our guests how to behave in a public space because they already know.
So how long before we're ready to go the Danish route?
Well, Professor Tony Blakely is an epidemiologist and a straight shooter, and he joins us now. Tony, what do you think of Denmark's decision?
Brave, but probably on the money. I think it is time where they are to be reducing restrictions, and I think we're not far away from on the east coast of Australia. Our numbers are coming down, the infection rates are certainly much lower, the hospital numbers are starting to track down. So I think this is the direction to move in.
Well, and inevitably I suppose we have to move in that direction. It's a question of how exactly you get there. I can't help but notice their hospitalisation and especially their ICU numbers per capita population seem a lot lower than ours. And I know they've got higher levels of boosting across, but it's still a big difference. What are they doing differently to get those results?
Yeah, so their ICU rates have dropped in the last week or so from about 90, which is about what New South Wales is, down to about 30. We're not far behind, but the other things they're doing is they've got very high vaccination rates, like 60%, I think, 60% of 5-plus-year-olds are boosted, whereas we're at about 40% of eligible here. And the other thing they've got is that they've had more infections wash through before Omicron. So they're going forward with both vaccine and many infections having been through the population before, which means they've got more immunity. Now, again, we're not far away from that. Omicron's going to affect about 50% of us, half of us. We're going to get to those same level of boosting of vaccination. So we will be in a similar place to Denmark soon.
What is soon, Tony? Like, what are we talking here? What do we need to do to get to that point?
Well, as far as the restrictions coming off, if I was the chief health officer, I'd be starting to ease things now because I really do think we're past the peak of the infection. So things like vaccine mandates and vaccine passports can be eased. And what I think we need to do for the rest of the year is we need to think more in terms of scenarios. So there still is, unfortunately, the chance of the really bad scenario, something as infectious as Omicron and as virulent as Delta. I hope it doesn't happen, but we need to be prepared for that. But then other scenarios include something a bit like Omicron or a bit like Delta. And what we do is we get ready for those things by warehouses full of masks, high-quality masks that we can roll out to the population if the proverbial hits the fan. Somebody order the RAT test, please, and let's stockpile those. And then back to vaccine passports, we need a system whereby we move to boosting, third dose being what you need, but we don't require people to show their vaccine passport when they go to a cafe all the time. We just turn those procedures on, turn those mechanisms on if we get another outbreak come our way. That's how we're going to exit the pandemic, dabbing the brakes occasionally and trying to work our way out of this.
Tony, always great to get your perspective. Thanks so much.
Pleasure.
I wonder whether it was interesting you were raising the point today about the motivation to get boosted if you remove the mandates and things. If we need to get to their level of being boosted to feel comfortable opening up, but how do you get
people motivated to be boosted? Like, I wonder if when we're quarantining now, if you're boosted, do you really need to be, if you're a household contact, do you really need to be quarantining for 7 days, I think it still is.
So if you create an exemption for that...
So finding motivation.
That's an incentive for people to get boosted. And it's keeping people, you know, the economy open.
It's interesting, because I know in the UK, which is not necessarily the model we should follow on COVID, but what's interesting about them is if you double dosed and someone in your house gets COVID, you're not under any restriction, or at least that was the case in December. So that sort of model has happened before, not with the boosted stuff. So it's not a completely stupid question. Like, it might actually be an interesting thought.
Thank you. Not a stupid question.
Sorry, that sounded more condescending than I meant.
2022 is off to a hot start for Petey.